from God to our eyes as we walk in the light and understanding God. Scripture says, if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we shall have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. That's a remarkable passage of Scripture that we are privileged of God to walk in the light. That also it shows forth that we have the privilege or the power of prerogative to not walk in the light. It is up to us to see that we walk in the light as He is in the light. There is a passage of Scripture that states that we should fear lest a promise being left us enter into His rest, that any of us seem to come short of it. Said because the gospel was preached unto the Jews or to the children of Israel under Moses coming up out of Egypt. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard. This glorious truth will not profit you unless it's mixed with faith. And may I add, obedience. God, when He called men and women to Him, His gift of eternal life is free. It's unmerited. God's great love wherewith He loved us, made provisions of our salvation, and the gift therein of eternal life. But there are other things that God will add to our eternal life, that we would glorify Him through, and He would glorify us by the thing that He has prepared for them that love Him. The Apostle Paul, having this in mind, he has this prayer in his heart, and it calls the attention of the saints at Thessalonica that he was praying for them always, that God would count them worthy of this calling and would fulfill all the good pleasure of His goodness and the work of faith and power, that the name of the Lord Jesus Christ would be glorified in the people of God, and they in Him. He thanked God always for what God had wrought in them. Their faith had grown exceedingly from the beginning of their Christian experience. Their love for everyone was also an abounding love. That so much the Apostle Paul gloried in the church there. They were not only strong in faith and abounding in love, but they were patient in tribulation and in persecution. They endured it. They were comforted by the Apostle when he said it was a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God that they would be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, which they also suffered. It's somehow ordained of God that suffering plays a part in our perfection, in our development, in our growth in Christ. It's a manifest judgment of God. And the Bible said, them that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. That if we suffer with Him, we'll also reign with Him. He suffered. How or why? It is all quite a mystery. But we are told that though He was a son, yet learned He obedience to the things that He suffered. And being made perfect through suffering, He became the author of eternal life. Yea, the captain of our salvation. We are told that He offers a cross to men and women to follow, that essayed to follow Him. He said, except the man to die himself and take up his cross, cannot be His disciple. This chemistry of perfection, of our perfecting, I may say, is God's judgment or ordained. It is what He perfects us through. And then he doesn't deliver us until a certain state of spiritual development that is designed by specific suffering has come, has been born. I was talking to two Christians the other day that were in a hard place. One of them prayed for God to deliver them out of it. I said, you shouldn't pray for God to deliver you out of it. You should pray for grace to stand in it. It was a matter of working for God in a place where things were hard and where people were uncooperative, where there seemed to be jealousy right among them, and sort of a condition where people were somewhat bound. But the people that seemed to be out of order, they stayed, and the folks that were spiritual left. I said, if people who have much grace can stand, you who are so full of grace and power and sweetness, as you think or claim, you ought to be able to stand and not give down or go away or run before the face of one that is obviously not spiritual. The scripture says it's a shame. It says, for a righteous man to fall down before the wicked is like the breaking out of many waters. God wants us to stand our ground. Having done all to stand, stand. His grace will not fail us. All we need to do in a tough proposition is ask for more grace. And it's plenty for you. Praise God, it's been tapped in Jesus Christ in the cross, on the cross. We're told in the first chapter of the Gospel of John of his fullness. We all receive grace for grace. Blessed be God. That means that the Lord, our God, will give us without restraint, without rationing, the grace sufficient for every ordeal and for every trial. There's no condition that God can't give you grace to stand and glorify him. Bless God by praising him. Isaiah said, glorify God in the fire. Praise the Lord. A lot of folks can glorify him under present condition, but when you're in the fire, glorify him. For it said, out of my stony grief, Bethel I'll raise. Hallelujah. And you can raise Bethel, for God is good when everybody else is mean. The Lord is still good, and his mercy endure forever. He wants to show his grace, show how a Christian can bear and take it. For life isn't as you make it. Life was already made before you got here. Life is as you take it. Your reaction, how you feel about what people say, what you endure, what you suffer. And if you got the right attitude of mind, with abounding grace in your soul, praise God, you can face the final world and laugh at Satan's rage. Yea, he'll anoint your head with oil, and your cup run over in the presence of the enemy. One old Christian that was so full of the grace of God, he said, not only my cup, but my saucer too, running over. Hallelujah. God will give you joy in place of sorrow. Amen. You give your love that cast out fear. You give your sunshine for your ashes and beauty for ashes here. Sunshine for your shadows and beauty for ashes here. Yes, he will. He said, this is his judgment, a manifest token of his judgment. When the Lord gives you to suffer for him, that's an honor. Shows that he's got confidence in you. Shows that he believes that you will take it. But he said, the people that bring suffering on you, you don't even have to worry. You don't even have to pay on them or tell God about them. For the Lord says, vengeance is mine. I will repay. Says, see, it's a righteous thing with God to recompense tribulation to them that trouble you. It's a righteous thing for God to look after the enemy. Amen. To recompense tribulation to them that trouble you. Then he said, and you who are troubled, rest with us. Rest. There's a rest in the time of trouble. Praise God, in a state and condition. I mean, that's obdurate, hard, I mean, and tough, and very painful. But God can give you rest of your soul. Torment and confusion may be around about you. But you know, when God gives you grace, who then, said Job, and he giveth peace, who then can make trouble? Great peace have they, said Isaiah, who love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. David said that. Yes, hallelujah, God, in the midst of trouble, he'll revive you. But all he wants you to let his peace abide in you. A ship that's like the United States new liner that made the record the other day, praise the Lord, it went through high winds, and perhaps strong winds, but it didn't mind because it had something down in the hull.